Welcome to this video in which we will give a short conceptual introduction of the frequency response of an FAR filter. The frequency response of a filter is a response to one or more phasor frequencies. Let's start our discussion with a very simple example, a delay. When using a phasor with frequency theta as input of such a delay, we can find an expression for the output by replacing the time index n by time index n minus 1. We can split this expression into two terms. The first term, in blue, is a complex number, which is a function of frequency theta. The second term is the same as the phasor at the input. When cascading four delays and using as input a phasor of frequency pi over 8, the output writes again as a product of two terms, a complex number, in blue, multiplied by a phasor with the same frequency as the frequency of the phasor at the input. In general, an FAR filter can be described by its impulse response Hn, and the output writes as a convolution sum of the input with the impulse response. For the given simple FAR example, the impulse response contains two terms, delta n plus delta n minus 4, which represents the two branches of the realization scheme. The convolution sum results in the difference equation yn is xn plus xn minus 4. When using a phasor of frequency pi over 8 as input, the output contains two terms, which are the result of the lower branch of the realization scheme, in blue, and the upper branch, in green. Since both terms contain the same phasor, we can combine the two terms. The first part of the resulting expression is a complex number, which can be written in a polar way as described in brown. Concluding, it follows that the output is a phasor, which is equal to the input phasor multiplied by a complex number. In other words, the simple FAR filter did not change the frequency of the input phasor, it has only changed its amplitude and phase. In general, we can describe the output of an FAR filter by a finite convolution sum between the impulse response Hn and the input signal Xn. When the input signal is a phasor with frequency theta, amplitude A and phase phi, the output writes as the given equation, which can be split again into two terms. The second term is the input phasor, and the first term is a complex number. Because of the fact that this derivation holds for any frequency, we can replace the specific frequency theta 1 by the variable frequency theta, and the first term becomes a complex function with function variable theta. This function is called the frequency response, which is denoted by the capital letter H. In a follow-up video, we will show that the frequency response is a periodic function, and for this reason, the function variable is not denoted by theta, but by e to the power j theta. Because of the fact that the frequency response is a complex function, we can write it in a polar way as the product of the magnitude, denoted by the absolute value of the frequency response, multiplied by a complex exponent containing the phase of the frequency response. Both magnitude and phase are functions of frequency theta. From the previous example, it follows that the frequency of the output phasor is the same as the frequency theta 1 of the input phasor. The FAR filter has changed the amplitude by the magnitude of the frequency response, evaluated at frequency theta 1, and the phase has changed by the phase of the frequency response, evaluated at frequency theta 1. From this discussion, it follows that there are different ways to describe the behavior of an FAR filter. On the one hand, with the impulse response, which writes in time domain as a weighted sum of shifted delta functions, and on the other hand, by the frequency response, which writes as a weighted sum of complex exponents. In the FER case, both summations have a finite number of elements. The impulse response Hn and the frequency response h e to the power j theta form a so-called Fourier pair. If we know the one, we can evaluate the other, and vice versa. We will use this simple FER example to show that the frequency response is a complex conjugated function when the impulse response, which represents the filter coefficients of the FER filter, are real numbers. From the realization scheme, it follows that the impulse response consists of the three given delta functions, which are multiplied by the real numbers minus 1, plus 3, and minus 1 respectively. By using the definition of the frequency response, we obtain the given expression, which consists of a weighted sum of complex exponents. As pointed out on the previous slide, these two expressions form a Fourier pair, so when we know one of the expressions, we can evaluate the other. When evaluating the complex conjugated version of the frequency response, we need to evaluate the complex conjugated versions of each individual term. Because of the fact that the filter coefficients are real, the complex conjugated versions of the filter coefficients stay the same, and the resulting expression is equal to the frequency response in which the function variable theta has been interchanged by minus theta. Thus, when the impulse response is real, the magnitude of the frequency response is a symmetric function of the frequency variable theta, and the phase is anti-symmetric. By using the previous result, we will now show how an FER filter influences a sinusoidal input signal. As a first step, we use Euler to write the sinusoidal signal as a sum of two phases. Furthermore, because of the fact that an FER filter is linear, we may shift the filter over the addition operation. The output of each FER filter is equal to the input phasor from which the amplitude and phase have been changed. Note that in the upper branch the frequency is plus theta 1 and in the lower branch minus theta 1. In our case, the FER filter has real filter coefficients, which implies that the frequency response has the complex conjugated property, which results in the expressions for the upper and lower branch that are complex conjugated. Combining the complex conjugated expressions results in a sinusoidal signal which has the same frequency as the input sinusoidal. The amplitude and phase have been changed by the FER filter as discussed before. This result can be expressed in the following figure. When applying a sinusoidal signal with frequency theta 1, amplitude A and phase phi to an FER filter, this will result into a sinusoidal output signal, from which the frequency is the same as the frequency of the input. In other words, when one period of the input signal consists of n samples, one period of the output will also contain n samples. The amplitude is changed by the magnitude of the frequency response, evaluated at frequency theta 1. And finally, the phase is changed by the phase of the frequency response, evaluated at frequency theta 1. It can be shown that this result holds for any LTI system. Thus, a basic property of any LTI system is that it cannot produce new frequencies. It can only influence amplitude and phase of frequencies that are applied to the input of the system. This basic property holds for any frequency. Thus, if we apply a DC signal with amplitude A0 to an FER filter, the output rises as the magnitude of the frequency response, evaluated at frequency 0, multiplied by A0. Furthermore, we have seen that the sinusoidal signal results into the same sinusoidal signal from its amplitude and phase are changed by the frequency response of the FVR filter at that particular frequency. Because of the fact that the FVR filter is a linear system, the addition of different signals at the input results in the addition of the individual resulting signals. It's obvious that this also holds for a summation of signals. In other words, superposition holds for the basic property of the previous slide. This ends this video in which we explained the concept of the frequency response of an FVR filter. Thank you for your attention.